I see all sort of signs this weekend at Walmart. Be my Valentine. Gordon, are you anybody's Valentine? Huh. Did anybody ask you to be your Valentine? What's that mean?
Huh?
No. I still don't know what that means.
I might not cry.
Oh, okay.
I'm going to cry that way. Yeah.
All of it, be my Valentine. And I bet the husband gives the wife some flowers, but mean as a junkyard dog the next day. You'll probably get on to him about that. But anyway, it's good to this time of year. Let's just go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for this night. And Lord, we thank you for the song service, the sweet spirit here tonight. And Lord, I ask you to forgive me my sins and hide me behind the cross. That every word, Lord, I'm going to say is going to bring honor and glory for you. And Lord, we just thank you and we love you. In the precious name of Jesus, amen.
Amen.
How will you show your love this Valentine's Day? If you're going to show it, you better hurry it up.
Amen.
Do you know that 62% of consumers plan to purchase at least one greeting card of all the consumers? That's about 1 billion cards exchange each year. 42% plan to spend an evening out. Is that any of y'all so far? 52.3% men plan to buy flyers this Valentine's Day. That's 180 million roses. 5.3% of men purchase clothing as gifts for their wives. $2.4 billion are spent on jewelry. Virginia's, the wheels are turning now, okay? 47.1% plan to buy candy. That is 36 million heart-shaped boxes of candy are sold on Valentine's. One way men can show their love for their spouses is in actions. You know, action speaks a lot louder than words, doesn't it?
Amen.
God showed us his love by action. John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Whosoever believeth him should not perish, but have everlasting life. We need to show our love by our actions. Remember when Jesus asked Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? He said that two or three times, and he said, feed my sheep. Do you love me? Feed my sheep. John 14:21 said, he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. By actions we can show how much we love God. We may say we love God more than anything, but do our actions show it?
Amen.
Try to look at three things that we must love God more than. We must love God more than our receptors by men. Amen. More than I expect. Men, Timon, let's just go to Matthew 16:23, okay? Maybe I can read it better and explain it. If that chapter's in here at this point, I don't know. Matthew 16:23. But he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Satan, that thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that have been. Men will tell you they care for you, don't they? We all want to be accepted, amen?
Amen.
Do you remember what it was felt? The first day at a new school, kids, was you nervous? Y'all were nervous? How about a new job? Your first day at a new job. How about you, Melissa?
No.
Was you nervous?
Yes.
How about when you walked into a new church you've never been?
Amen.
Do you wonder maybe somebody could come over here and talk to me? Or did somebody let you sit over at the side like you had leprosy? Wouldn't come over here to talk to you?
Not a
minister. No, you're right there, girl. You'll be talking. You're not going to get out of that. I tell folks, if they don't want to be hugged, they better not come in here.
Amen.
Some people will go to great extremes to be accepted. Some will join gangs. Some will give their bodies to be accepted, unfortunately. Some have given in to perversion and homosexuality.
Yep.
Being a disciple will not make you be accepted by men. Let's go to Matthew 10, verses 17, 18, and 22, please. Matthew 10, verses 17, 18, and 22, please. Verse 17 says, but be aware of men, for they will deliver you up to the councils. They will scourge you in their synagogues. Amen. Let's go to 18. And you should be brought before the governor and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them and the Gentiles. I slide on down to verse 22. And you should be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that doeth to the end shall be saved. They murmured against Moses. They threw Jeremiah in the pit. They stoned Paul and left him for dead. They left John in a deserted island of Patmos. People today, these guys today and women, if you won't drink with me or smoke with me or do drugs with me or tell dirty jokes or cuss like a sailor, have sex, and you talk about it, then I ain't got time for you. Mm-hmm. You see people, I like to watch it, Mother Gordon. When you go out and eat, and everybody is eating away, and you offer thanks for food. I like to watch them do this. We had one guy. He was from Mulberry, Arkansas. Went to this big restaurant, Miss Kathy. Everybody was just as quiet, and he just gets up and said, let us pray! People were knocking stuff down. But you go to church every Sunday. Even obey the Ten Commandments, or try to. Stand for what's right. Now you believe in the Bible, tell others about Jesus, you'll be ridiculed. Look how Hollywood portrays Christians.
Amen.
Donald Trump says he's a good Christian. You figured out how he said that yet. What do you got to mean? Ask if you sin, he said, I don't know if I have enough. If I do, I just eat a little away from the ancient Jews. They'd be fine. But our movies in Hollywood are rated. Our movies are rated by Hollywood. Even Tim Tebow is still making fun of it. And good role models he is. And yet they'll take up and really promote somebody that looked like a demon, but not Tim Tebow. Liberals get nervous when Christian shows come on. Let me say something. The other night at Super Bowl, something's been under my craw ever since I heard that. I like Peyton Manning. I think he's a good guy. I think he's a good player. I think he's a good role model. But here he was saying, when I get done from here, I'm going to kiss my wife and drink a lot of Bud Light. Right before that, he said, I want to thank the good man up above. You know, that hurt him right there. There were a lot of people, you know. He's not perfect, but he just got through praising the Lord up above and we'll go and drink some Bud Light, you know. So, you know, what little I disagree ain't gonna hurt him, but I think we've got to be careful of his role model that we set with people. When Jesus walked the earth, people would get nervous. Barbara's faith that she grew up in, preacher we had down there was a missionary Baptist preacher. Well, he made them all nervous when he walked around. He used to be in that church. And he'd say, that Baptist heathen doesn't do it around here again. But Steve did it just to be honored, I guess. And when her mama died, everybody was all around. I'm not making fun of her. Brother Steve walked in there like walking tall. I hear she parked. That's the way Jesus was. When he walked through, people got nervous. People got nervous. Have you ever been out of church and go to the grocery store and all you meet is the people who go to church? Amen. Have you? We sure miss you at church. People didn't want to hear that though, because we look at our own lives and say, we got a lot of improving to do. What do you think about a person who said they loved you but didn't want to tell anybody about you? They didn't want to be seen with you, but they tell you they love you. They wouldn't admit to knowing you if they were asked. But we tithe. We're tight. You would soon figure out they really didn't care a rip about you. You know what?
No.
Example of Peter, when he said he loved Jesus more than anyone, he denied Jesus before the campfire. No wonder Jesus asked him, "Do you love me? Do you love me?" Everyone that Jesus called, he called them publicly. Do you love me? Do you love me? Today, if you're not willing to claim Jesus publicly, then you don't really love him like you say you are.
Amen.
This is what's called love in action. You will run across quite a few people today for this week. Let me tell you about our revival. Let me tell you about Jesus, what he's done for me. Yeah. You see, preacher, I don't know a whole lot about it. Tell them what Jesus done for you.
Amen.
You ain't got to be no scholar. We must love God more than our families.
Amen.
They said that a parent's love for a child can be a great one. This little country called Armenia, 1989, an 8.2 earthquake flattened the country. Father was digging at the schoolhouse where his son was. And he kept digging and digging and digging. 38 hours nonstop. People tried to discourage him. He said, "No, I'm going to get my son out." Kept digging, digging, digging. He said, "Aren't you going to help me?" They said on the 39th hour, he pulled back and found his son and 14 other children. And his son said, "See there? I told you Dad wasn't going to leave me." That's a parent's love to son. Poor boy loses his mother, can't afford a headstone. He buys a piece of scrap of stone, places it on her grave, tries to scratch the words, "My mother, she died last week. She was all I had. She said she would be waiting for me." So the man saw his work and noticed he had stopped. The young boy ran to his mother's grave one evening, and the man had put a gravestone on his mother's grave and wrote, "He loved his mother." Mm-hmm. Loved his mother. Man's love for a woman and a woman's love for a man would be special. When two people get married, they became one. That means they have to trust each other. Yeah. They may not always get the things they want. May not always win our arguments, man, do we? We know when to shut up. Dr. Ronnie Floyd of the biggest Southern Baptist church in Arkansas, in Springdale, Arkansas, he said, "Not all battles are worth fighting for."
Amen.
Yeah. That's a lot of truth in that. Man, when you get married, you don't get to hang out with the boys no more, do you? Get to drag man no more. And women, you know, vice versa. marriage is no longer 50-50 anymore.